For the band, though, it was business as usual. Schoolwork to do and gigs.
They said that they would support Nancy Vandal and the Pop Gun Assassins at the Vulcan on this particular Saturday night. And, of course, the Vulcan, at best, holds a couple of hundred people. I mean, and even that is like a sardine can. Well, there must have been at least 500 people trying to get into that hotel on this Saturday night. By the end of the show, the security had all had to come inside the hotel and had formed a line in front of this pathetic little drum risers acting as a stage. And this line of security literally pushing people back because they were ending up all over in Ben's lap on the kit.
In early spring of 1994, public interest in the band was building.
I actually had someone ring up when they were still the Innocent Criminals. It was only a couple of weeks after we started playing the track. And as a guy, he sounded like he was in about his mid-30s, and he rang up and he wanted to request a song. And I said, oh, you know how young these guys are, because at that stage, a lot of people didn't know. And he went, oh, isn't that amazing? It's just something about that song that just sums up the way I'm feeling at the moment.
A potential hit song was getting national airplay on Triple J, and still no record company contract or CD in sight.
It got then into, I guess, a bit of a contractual contest between ourselves and another label. And at that point, you know, it was just like a to-ing and fro-ing thing, hoping that we'd sign the band. And we did.
The band finally chose Murmur, the second band to join the new record label.
At least they're not cocks.
We got along well. All of the fathers are big rugby league fans, and so am I. So maybe that stood me in good stead or something, I don't know.
In September, Tomorrow was released at last, together with three new tracks recorded in the Triple J studios. On the front of the CD was a sticker which read, by Silverchair, formerly Innocent Criminals.
Tomorrow there from, well, a band that used to be called the Innocent Criminals, now they're called Silverchair, and Ben and Daniel are with me tonight on the Australian Music Show. So why the name change from the Innocent Criminals to Silverchair? If this was TV, you would have seen two fingers going at each other. You're sick of that question, right? Were you sort of attached to the name Innocent Criminals?
No, really. We hated it.
So you were glad to see it go.
Yep.
You just needed an excuse.
Like, we liked it. We liked it when we first made it up, but then, like, I'd say about three weeks later, we hated it.
The guys put it to us, what do you think of our name? We said we thought the name sucked, but if they liked it, you know, ultimately after you establish your music, what's in a name? Fortunately, they thought their name sucked too.
Where did the name Silverchair then come from?
Gay Ben.
Do you want to hear the whole story?
Oh, nothing but.
Okay.
Daniel and Chris were at my house one day, and we were ringing up radio stations requesting songs.
Triple J, of course.
Actually, we couldn't get through. I wanted to request Sliver, and Daniel wanted to request Berlin Chair by
UMI.
And just as a joke, we said, how about we request Sliverchair? And then Chris wrote it down, and he switched the letters around, and it said...
Accidentally.
Accidentally.
And it said Silverchair.
Because you're so good at spelling.
Yeah.
And then we just said, Silverchair!
Yeah, and we just said, that's a good name.
Can you remember any of the other suggestions that were floating around for names?
I think one was Warm Fish Milkshake, but that didn't last very long. Grunt Truck was another good one, but that had gone, actually.
Why do you spell Silverchair with a small S, too?
Because we want to.
We're not that special.
Modesty gets you to make it a small S.
Yeah.
No, we've got to make it a small S because a big S looks stupid.
What? It's stupid where? What,
it
impressed?
It just looks dumb.
Look, we'll write it down and have a look.
Yeah, look, write it down. What? And pause.
Okay, no, okay. Hang on.
He's in the process of writing it right now.
I don't know. I've written. I always write Silverchair with a capital S. I mean, what's so stupid about that?
It just looks spastic. See, it looks mental.
Now do it with a little one.
Yeah.
Well, I'm looking at your press release on the other side that's got a small S.
Yeah, it looks much better.
Yeah.
The song went on to spend 6 weeks at number one on the Australian Singles Chart. In January 1995, Silverchair released their second single, Pure Massacre, which went all the way to number two.
There's a time on telly, like every time like you turned on the telly, there's all this war on telly, and so I decided to write a song about it.
People dying for no reason at all, and it's no different.
That summer, they were on the Big Day Out tour and travelled to Auckland, New Zealand for a show that they remember well.
Oh, and all the gear wasn't there, eh?
Yeah, I was really nervous.
They had no gear till about 30 seconds before it went on.
Where was the gear?
It was gone because we had to hire it, and then we ended up getting the wrong gear.
We wrote all the gear down, nothing turned up.
And nothing turned up, we had no equipment in the can. We just out there and we didn't have any answers. We went, excuse me.
So what'd you do? Just played with borrowed equipment?
Yeah.
I use the Clouds amp or something, I think.
And I wouldn't have a clue who's I used.
Already plans were underway for the new album and the United States. At the Melbourne Big Day Out gig, executives from the US flew in to check out the band.
Keep moshing. You up in the tree, that's good moshing in the tree. We've never seen that before.
I think the Americans saw something, you know, happening here. You'd have to be blind not to see it. And then they took the album as it was, the artwork, the band, and they just thought, this is really strong. We don't need to mess with it.
At the end of March 1995, Silverchair's first album was released.
You didn't just simply want to call it Silverchair, you wanted to give it a name?
Yeah. We don't like self-titled albums. It's too boring.
It was called Frogstomp.
What's the symbolism behind calling it Frogstomp and all the frogs that are inside the CD as well?
I was just at a guy from the record company's house and we were looking at some CDs, trying to look for an album cover name.
And they came across an old Stax series of records, and it's an instrumental, and everyone just thought, oh, that's a good name.
That sounded good, and it looked good when you read it on paper, so I said, yeah, let's call it that, and he goes, yeah, okay. So the moral of the story is the album doesn't mean anything.
When Triple J interviewed Daniel and Chris about the album, they seemed more concerned about the music than the success.
All we want the album to do is hang around in the alternative charts in the top 20 for a while, and then it can drop out and do whatever it wants.
Yeah, it can run away, it can do whatever it like.
You don't really care.
But it's not going to do that, is it?
Yep.
No, it's going to go number one. it's pretty odds on that it's going to go number one when it's released next week.
Well, I hope it doesn't go number one in the mainstream charts, that's all I've got to say.
This is great. I'm actually speaking to a band that doesn't want the success. It's very rare.
Oh. No, and it's not that we don't want success. We just don't want to get established as a mainstream teen band.
Frogstomp went straight to number one and stayed there for 3 weeks. But it wasn't exactly what the band or their record company were after.
It's kind of annoying. Like, the whole idea when we signed the contract was to keep, like, hype down to a minimum and stuff and not do any magazines that we don't want to do and crap like that. And, like, then magazines that we don't want to turn up in put us on the cover and just get bits out of other interviews we've done and put them in and make it look
like
we've done an interview with them, but we haven't.